snow came unusually early this winter, and now on BBC Two, we spare a thought for motorists with a poem for drivers.
Best and brightest come away, fairer far than this fair day, which, like thee, to those in sorrow, comes to bid a sweet good morrow to the rough year just awake in its cradle on the break.
The Network Q RAC Rally, watched by 2 million hardy souls from any available vantage point. Britain's biggest and often coldest spectator event. This year, winter came early to hold it in an icy grip. So dawn on a November Sunday morning in Birmingham Centenary Square. The crowd's there to see newly crowned world champion, Juha Kankkunen. Britain's great rallying hope, Colin McRae in the Subaru, was the popular choice for success. But would it be his year? 4 days then of breakneck speed through Britain, starting with the spectator stages of the Midlands, the treacherous Welsh Forest, then Kilwa and the north before the return home. 1,600 miles and 35 stages. A fun drive it was definitely not.
Champion Kankkunen's Toyota was instantly setting the pace, with Welshman Nicky Grist providing his invaluable, precise advice.
Long flat left, then 50 over Frost. Turn long, fast right, Frost.
Colin McRae was having his first competitive outing in the Subaru in Pretzer, steering a steady middle course. Unlike Francois Delacour, who chose the scenic route, much to the detriment of his escort Cosworth's bodywork. Quite a big way, but one of the estate trees gone. Already second twice in this event, Sweden's Kenneth Eriksson was hoping for top spot this time in the new Mitsubishi Lancer. Finland's Ari Vatanen was competing on his 89th championship rally. But would it be his last for Subaru, who've signed Carlos Sainz for next season? Frenchman Didier Auriol was hoping to end the season just as he started it at Monte Carlo with a sensational win. But the sensation of day one was Germany's Armin Schwarz and the underestimated Mitsubishi. Driving with flair and a little luck, he led the rally until this moment at Clumber Park cost him vital seconds. Cumbria's Malcolm Wilson was perhaps trying too hard in his own team escort. Why is it always a co-driver's window that gets broken?
Turn K-left, Frost.
Richard Burns had just become the youngest ever British champion. And even this impromptu shower couldn't dampen his determination.
Slippy.
Gwyndaf Evans was flying in his escort Cosworth, setting the fastest overall time at Western Park, a unique achievement for a Group N car. David Llewellyn was unchallenged in Formula 2 in the British Championship. Here, though, it was a different story. His biggest rival was the Formula 2 newcomer, Grégoire de Mavius, looking sharp in the Nissan, despite only 2 days of testing. But not everything went according to plan.
You'll get, but you've got a six for the Russian judge for the spin.
Here was a famous name, Matthew Clark, in his first RAC rally, hoping to emulate the achievements of his father, Roger, who last won in 1976. Maybe one to watch in the future. Paul Curdley from Leeds began the day in 59th spot. He enjoyed the spectator stages, jumping to 17th by the end of the day. And here was a Red Arrows squadron leader in a red VW Golf, Simon Mead from Lincolnshire, raising money for the charity Childline. Then the college team from Chesterfield with Jeff Lennox at the wheel. They were soon to find all this an education. The youngest team featured Richard and Katie Tuthill in the tiny 650cc Subaru Vivio. The reigning ladies champion, Penny Mallory, in the Wash and Go Escort, she couldn't get day one out of her hair and retired. Here's how the Italian driver does it. Antonella Fidanza flooded his engine on stage two, spun his car on stage four, then retired on stage five. It was just like driving back home. As day one ended, Juha Kankkonen led the field back to Birmingham. The world champion looked every inch that with a sizable lead.
Very, very long flat left tightens into long easy left, keep in, and turn long bad right.
It was quite a difficult day, let's say, today, because the conditions were quite changing all the time. But I took right tyres for every stage and went very well today.
So a 9-second lead and then you're off into Wales leading the rally. Is that the way you want to do it?
I don't know. I mean, depends about the weather. But if it's tomorrow, if it's snowing or something, I think I'm a little bit into shit then. But if it's dry, then it's all right.
Wales didn't offer a warm welcome to the 146 survivors from the 168 starters, and it soon proved to be an unhappy dawn for the Mitsubishi pair. First, Armin Schwartz dropped into a ditch, and from second place to 77th. Then the luckless Ericsson lost 3 minutes and 8 places to a puncture. It was a catalyst for an incredible fight break.
30. Very. 30, very long medium right, opens.
And even Kankkonen, seeking his third RAC victory, was lucky to be kept on track by the scenery.
Okay.
It was just one slow corner and was icy on the braking like the whole stage. But I just, there were some logs, not logs, but just cutty trees hanging side of the road. And I just touched them a little. No speed, but just made a little damage.
We've come through without any problems, but I mean, it was very gentle in there.
How bad was the ice?
Diaoletic.
What does that mean?
I don't think I should say that in English.
Morning. Comparing notes, are we?
Yeah, is it a good morning or not? I'm not sure.
No, you're not going to be critical of Welsh stages, are you?
Well, I must say that at least the surface was the same all the way through anyway, even though there was no grip at all. It was incredibly slippery, just packed ice most of the way, so it was tricky. But very much to my surprise, we caught Matthew Clark in there and passed him, so we had a bit of snow dust off him, so I thought, oh, we must be going reasonably well. We got to the end and saw a stage time, and we were like eighth quickest or something, so we were amazed by that, and pleased, of course. Probably go off in the next one, mate.
Robbie Head had already been visiting the ditches.
You have to try and use most of the road and use all the ditches to try and get some traction. There was a big hole and it's bent the front suspension and the sump guard brackets, etc. So the boys are repairing it just now.
The conditions seem atrocious. The ice seems really bad. How bad is it?
We seen Torval and Dean on one stage and they was like, they couldn't stand up, you know? It was that bad.
By far the biggest team on the event was Subaru, fielding two Legacies and two Imprezas for McRae and the veteran Vatanen. But the rally is no respecter of reputations. Ari was caught out by the conditions here. the team was an interesting mix of young and old, with 22-year-old Richard Burns guiding his legacy lightly over the ice, poetry in motion. The Subaru squad was backed by nearly 100 support crew, including the vital trailblazers with their up-to-the-minute ice notes.
Stage 14 is Diffie, 14.75 miles. General description, temperature minus 1 degree, similar to stage 13. 30% ice, ice in shaded parts visible or marked. Last mile, all ice to finish. Ditch is okay, but not as good as previous. And there's 8 individual notes marking mostly slippy ice, some under braking.
Of course, even the most meticulous advice cannot prevent mishaps, which call for some less than delicate repairs. The less fortunate private crews have to take pot luck, with inevitable consequences. This sudden halt, Carlisle's Dougie Watson-Clark made it to Mahuntlet in better shape than his car.
As you can see, the car's quite badly damaged, but although it still runs all right, it's whether the organisers will let us carry on. The scrutineers will come and have a investigate the car, but the cage is all twisted inside and maybe it would be a bit silly to carry on, because if we had another accident, you know, we might not be as lucky the next time.
Not surprisingly, Dougie decided to call it a day. Colin McRae was once again showing that nobody does it better on the Welsh stages. He was gradually closing the gap on Kankanen's Toyota. The Finnish world champion kept his cool and listened intently to a Welshman beside him, co-driver Nicky Grist.
70, flat right, 70, long easy right, and flat left, 50, easy right, and 70, small crest, patchy ice, turn, very long bad right, opens, into long easy right over crest, 70.
The Mitsubishi of Kenneth Eriksson was climbing through the field again after nearly going out of contention. François Delacour in the Escort Cosworth was also going well, up to fifth spot now. And a sight to gladden British eyes, Malcolm Wilson still among the pacemakers, a real gutsy performance. Richard Burns was showing what an emerging talent he is. By the end of day two, he was in seventh spot. Not too far behind was Robbie Head in the Group A Escort. He was handsomely placed in 11th position, just ahead of the Welshman Gwyndaf Evans, who often comes unstuck on home territory. Not today, he was lying 12th. Armin Schwartz was positively charging up the field to end the day 14th. Jimmy McRae had a good return in the Golf, but luck went against him. He hit a rock and retired on the last Welsh stage. And how does a Finn tackle an icy corner? Sebastian Lindholm demonstrates. David Llewellyn tries it the Welsh way in the Astra. Not much better, really, was it? The end of day two, and it was just like last year. Colin McRae had forced his way into the lead by 21 seconds. So a hero's welcome for the Subaru in Lancaster. Was it to be McRae's year at last? His fans certainly thought so.
Tell me, what have the stages been like today in Wales?
They've been very slippy. It's been like driving in an ice rink most of the time. Very difficult.
Lots of people have had lots of problems. What's been your problem at all?
None at all. That's why we're leading.
The tranquility of Lakeland in November was soon to be shattered.
The Network Q RAC Rally is Britain's biggest spectator event, and standing here on this Lakeland fell farm that's been turned into one of the many car parks around the Grisdale Forest complex, you can see why. And what's more, it's been like this since 5 o'clock this morning.
Colin McRae had twice come to grief at Grisdale during the past 2 years, so the rally leader approached the 22 miles with understandable trepidation. He emerged unscathed and still with a 23-second lead.
I've got away with it this time. Quite pleased.
What was that stage like?
It was difficult. It was like two good tracks and then very gravelly at the side. And because the road's so hard, if you got on the gravel, it was even slippier than the ice. So really, I didn't drive as well as I would like to have. I was a bit too sideways in a lot of places, but I'm sure the spectators enjoyed it.
The wily Kankanen seemed quite content to play second fiddle and follow in Colin's wheel tracks. He was certainly happy with the conditions today.
Much better than the other stages. There was actually no ice, just a little, but not much.
You beat Colin McRae by 5 seconds. What were his wheel marks like ahead of you?
Good. I mean, it's sliding quite a lot and quite wide in places, but it's much better to drive behind than to be first car. Now I realize it, because it's cleaning up a lot.
So you've got an advantage as you go into Kielder now?
It depends how the weather is in Kielder. We will see how much snow there is.
There was more than enough snow to add to the excitement, but this was soon to be the least of Colin McRae's concerns. He may have escaped his Grisdale jinx, but this time it was to be the curse of Kershaw.
Well, here we are in Kershaw Forest, and drama has hit the Network QRAC rally with the leader, Colin McRae, in great trouble. Smoke and steam, we've just arrived. Derek, I know Colin's just not here at the moment. What's happened?
Yeah, we've lost all the water. Ran about 15 miles with no water in the engine, and I think it's probably finished, but we're just going to try and start it again now it's cooled down a bit. You can see all the steam coming.
Did you lose a lot of time in there?
I think probably about 3 minutes. We had to drive very, very slowly. We just got it out of the stage, and then it stopped, it seized.
What was the cause of it, Colin? Did the hose just go, or did you bump on something?
No, it's the bottom of the radiator's broken. It's all the rocks just come up and caught the radiator. Broke the bottom of it, so all the water's gone.
So, do you think you can do anything?
I don't think. I think the engine's been too badly cooked now. It did most of the stage with no water in it.
Even brotherly assistance from Alistair McRae, who shepherded him to the next emergency service, and some heroic work by the ProDrive mechanics, couldn't save the day.
That's a paperclip or something like that, just to get
We won't give up until the very last second. We'll just keep it going. We can get the engine fired up again now. What it is, he's damaged the radiator and lost all the water, so it's got very hot, the engine. We're just trying to get it, build some compression back into it now. These engines are staggering what they'll survive.
How long's he got before he's out?
Another 25 minutes, something like that, so it's still plenty of time.
All the efforts were in vain. The damage had been done.
So it was left to the Mitsubishi of Kenneth Eriksson to chase Kankanen now, a Scandinavian 1 and 2.
Crest and turn.
Malcolm Wilson was virtually on home territory in Grisdale, but that counts for nothing in rallying.
70. Crest to 2, easy left.
As he approached Coniston Services, his Escort wasn't in showroom condition.
What happened was a big jump in there, and then the car landed with sort of one wheel off the road. And I think just in the ditch there must have been a big stone or something like that, and it just bent the suspension leg, which in turn put the tyre into the suspension. So, of course, we had to do about 6 miles with with no tyre on, because then it just took the tyre off the rim.
So how much has that robbed you in time?
Probably 20-odd seconds, 30 seconds probably.
So, Grisdale, you see?
Grisdale, too close to home, you see.
Malcolm's malaise benefited his Ford teammate, François Delacour. On a scale of 1 to 10, he gave Grisdale 10 points.
So then what, now, what was that like?
It was not super easy this morning. No, the stage was nice, very nice. Just a little bit icy, but not so much.
You you made the fastest time in there.
Yeah, Grisdale is absolutely fantastic, special stage. It was very nice, very, very nice.
David Llewellyn wasn't so enthusiastic about Grisdale, but then nor was his car, especially after this. Sebastian Lindholm was living up to his flying fin reputation. Amazingly, he was unscathed. And all bets on William Hill ended in Grisdale 2. Robbie Head had given it his best shot, but his rally ended in the snow of Kielder. In Group N, Johnny Milner had more than just snow to battle against. He was having his own personal tussle with the Subaru legacy of Mike Rimmer, who seemed at home on the snow.
Today has been good fun. Yesterday was absolutely dreadful. But we seem to have sort of moved up from the nursery slopes to the black runs quite well.
No jokes about a Skoda, please. Emil Trinner was driving his brilliantly to move into 14th spot. Trevor Smith's Peugeot was handling snow well too on his first Formula 2 outing. British junior champion Brendan Creeley was playing it safe in the Honda Civic. And Paul Dias was pleased to see the back of Grisdale after last year's demise here.
120.
Mad Mick Jones was having a ball in the Mitsubishi, despite the concern of co-driver Neil Dashfield.
Steady, Mick. Okay. Fat, four left.
I can handle this, it's really good. We got the right car with the right tyres, and it's just going really well at the moment. We're not having to try too hard. We're very lucky to come out of Kershop as the one who didn't have the problems. I think we've got a lead of about 5 or 6 minutes now in the amateur category.
So how important is it for you to try and win this amateur category?
It's crucial, because that's half my budget for doing the RAC.
Well, we'll keep our fingers crossed for you, Mick.
Thank you.
No worries about money for Juha Kankanen. The world champion was looking awesome. A lead of 1 minute and 21 seconds at the end of day three. Could anyone 50. Stop him now?
Crest, 150. Medium left over bumps. And long, fast right.
The final day, and snowy North Yorkshire's answer to breakfast at the Savoy. Candelabra and all.
This is a little bit high, David.
But nobody could hold a candle to Kankanen. He would set four fastest times on the seven final stages to increase his lead over Kenneth Eriksson. Once again, the determined Swede would have to settle for second place for the third time in 4 years. The home hero, after perhaps the grittiest drive of his career, was Malcolm Wilson.
28 miles to go now, Malcolm. Are you going to settle for third place? How does that feel?
Oh, you're not kidding. I mean, in there was just absolutely incredible. I mean, we were seeing speeds on the monitor here of approaching 130 mile an hour on 100% snow, and then all of a sudden, you know, you'd be 100 mile an hour, and then the car would just step completely sideways.
Flat left, long over crest, 30, easy left, slippy.
Richard Burns once again demonstrated his precocious talent.
His reward will be quite a contrast to these snowy conditions. A Subaru drive in the Asia Pacific Championship next year. Gwyneth Evans not only won the showroom class, but brought his Group N Escort home in 11th place overall. Formula 2 leader David Llewellyn was perhaps lucky to survive the final day after an off-stage incident.
We had a bit of a coming together on the road back there with a local. So they did quite a lot of damage to the front right-hand strut of the car and so forth. So we've just had to put a new corner on it, basically.
Has he lost you much time on the road, you know?
Yeah, we only just got in by 3 minutes, unless we've been out of the rally. So hopefully we can get to the end now.
He did make it, 12th overall, and the first two-wheel drive car on the leaderboard. Mick Jones certainly earned his £2,500 check. 14th overall, and the first amateur home. Ulsterman Brendan Creeley made it into the top 30, despite his unique approach to the conditions.
We're getting into it now. It's actually easier if you go a bit quicker. If you try going too slow, it makes it more difficult to drive in the snow. We're quite enjoying it now.
Another happy driver was Leicester Steve Green, who won his class in his privateer Astra. Emil Trinner added a 20th RAC class win to Skoda's catalogue of rally successes. Paul Kirtley brought his Sierra home in a most creditable 20th place. Red Arrow's pilot Simon Mead was cautiously on target. He finished 76th at his first attempt. A surprise success, a class win for Japan's Masayuki Yamada, 38th overall in the 79-horsepower VVO. Quite a contrast to the 350-horsepower Toyota, driven superbly by the most successful rally driver of all time. This was Juha Kankkonen's 20th championship win and a richly deserved first home victory for co-driver Nicky Grist.
200. Okay. Well done, Boyle. That's a good one to win for you.
A fitting end to a triumphant year for Toyota.
But I'm not going to say it's slippery, Tony.
It was very slippery.
There you go, very slippery. I said it.
It's not slippery this morning. No, the stage was nice, very nice.
It's much better to drive behind than to be first car. Now I realize it.
Next year. I said that last year. Hard luck, Colin.
100. Long K right. 50. Keep left over long crest and turn long K right. And then and long K right. 50. Flat right and long flat left over crest. 50. Small crest of flat left 150.